So you're going to read this little paragraph here, and I'm going to ask you specifically, why do we need the service valves, and what are we using the gauges for? And then there's three positions of these valves that you're going to learn about today that you got to master. Backseated? Well, that's one. You tell me the other two. I gave you one. It's all on that page, so just read that over real quick. Those of you that are done tracing out page 90 of the modern refrigeration air conditioning text, okay? That's just figure 2-78, and we're going to talk specifically about that. Trying to sell. Let's see if you can buy a box of air for $5. Plus shipping. Alright, so those of you that aren't done tracing, let's go ahead. We'll get back to that. Okay, we'll finish it up. Everybody's got the colored pencils too. We got four different types of colored pencils. Said to get that. Alright, what colors did I say? No, nobody's got colored pencils. Oh, you set. Look at that. You brought your own personal set. That's fancy. Day right now, that's success right there. Yeah, so red, we're gonna match it up with red, green, blue, and I have black, so you just use your regular pencil. You're also gonna need a set of these gauges because I want you to take them apart. I'm gonna pass around each set of bar gauge manifolds. These are without the hoses. Normally when you become a service tech, you need to buy these. It's one of the tools that you'll purchase. They run for about $150 most of the time. Although they do average, you can pass a couple more back. Sometimes on sale, maybe $75, $100, depending on the manufacturer you get. Some of these are really old, from the 60s. They have glass fronts. Be careful with those. That's real glass. Okay? They used to have real glass before they started using plastic caps. I think everybody got a set of gauges. Pass those down. RJ, take one, pass them down. Anybody need any more? You got one?
Yeah.
No, you can take your own. Sorry. You can have your own. You can have your own. We got enough for everybody. Now look, technically in order to handle these gauges in the HVAC field, you got to be EPA certified in refrigerant recovery and handling. So really, you cannot handle or buy these gauges until you get certified by the EPA. And there's several organizations that do that. And if you come back to level two, it is one of the things that you will have by the time you graduate. We've had 100% success rate with the students that have wanted to take this test and pass it for the last 5-6 years, both at the college, the University of DC, and here with you guys. So we've had a tremendous success rate with everybody passing the test, and you cannot handle these gauges until you pass that test. That's a $37,500 fine if they catch you walking around with these gauges and you don't have your EPA license to back up that you know what you're doing with these yet. But for education purposes, we're gonna take them apart, we're gonna take a look at them a little bit. You had to draw something called the Bourdon tube. Have any of you ever gone to a party and you got one of those party favors, it's all rolled up, and then you blow on it, and then it goes, like that, you like that? It's the sound effects, right? How's it go? Sounds like a sick elephant. The same thing happens here. The same thing with this tube. I want you to take this apart. This plastic case, some of them have a little cover like this that just pops off. Others have a cover that unscrews from the front, like that. And then some, if you got one of the older set of gauges, careful, it's glass, you might need to come up and grab a screwdriver from the toolbox, and you're gonna take the cover off like that. Now some, try and find one that maybe doesn't have a cover, or a plastic cover. If you wanna trade in the glass one, because you don't wanna risk breaking it, for a plastic one, I have a plastic one up here. But you're going to take that cover off, and I want you to look behind the gauge. So like mine here, I'm going to take this cover off right here like that. And then it still doesn't come off until I remove the screw that's in the back. Now these gauges have all been trashed, so that's why we're using these. But I'm going to take a Phillips, pull the screw off, and then if you can peel back, don't break it, and don't peel back to where it bends the metal. If you got a metal one, just peel back a little bit like that, let it drop back, so you can see the mechanisms inside. You'll see the Bourdon tube, you'll see the gears. The gears connect to the needle in the front, and you can pull and push on it a little bit, and watch what happens to the needle. When I push down, the needle drops. When I pull up, like I'm trying to straighten it out, the needle goes up, because that's how the needle works. The needle works through the gear, and then it's got this mechanism that connects to the Bourdon tube that when the pressure comes in from whatever we're hooking up to, unit, tank of refrigerant, the pressure pushes that Bourdon tube like that party favor trying to straighten it out. And when it does that, that moves the mechanism, which in turn turns the gear to register some sort of value up here on our gauge. Now, we're not going to get into all the numbers and what they mean today. That's going to be another lesson. But you just need to understand how this pressure gauge works and what we use it for. Now, this is not the only type of pressure gauge we use. In here, when you read Doolin's chapter 1 the other day, they were talking about the second law of thermodynamics, about heat always flowing to cold. And the principle that they told you about was like a U-tube. This is the original U-tube. Before U-tube was popular with the internet, this was it. This was the tool that the technicians used to measure pressure. And it's just a different gauge other than this one here. Because this measures in, anybody know how this measures? What we use to measure? Like if you had to fill up your car tire or your PSI, bike tire. PSI. Yeah, you'd find something with a PSI. What does that mean? Pound per square inch. It's just a unit of measurement. We'll talk about that a little later. But there's other units of measurement, like what do I have inside here? What does that clear liquid look like to you?
Water.
Yeah. And how are they measuring this column of water? Because that's really what I have. I have two columns of water, one on either side. And then what unit of measurement does it look like they're using here? What does that look like? Looks like a tape measure, yep. And then what's inches? So inches, so they're measuring inches of water column. It takes 27 inches of water to register 1 PSI on a gauge. So when this thing fills up to 27, that's gonna register down here at the bottom. If I put the gauge down here at the bottom, 1 PSI. If I had like, what is 27 and 27? 20 and 20 is 40, 7 and 7 is 14, it's 54. If I had 54 inches of water, it would register what then? 2 PSI, yeah. So this is a smaller unit of measurement than PSI, because we can use this to hook up to our units in HVAC, but we can't use this to measure the airflow in our ductwork. The unit of measurement is so small, the pressure is a lot smaller. So to measure our airflow in our ductwork, we would take a tool like this, I'd drill a hole in it and shove it in the ductwork, and what would happen is that one side of the water from the air pressure, what's going to happen? One side goes down, one side goes up. And the way we take the unit of measurement from this manometer, this U-tube manometer, is that we add the two in the separation from zero. So if it goes up 5 inches and down 5 inches, I have a total of 10 inches of water column pressure. 10 inches of water column pressure. So that's how they measure with the U-tube. And it's always trying, just like heat's moving warmer to cooler, it's always gonna try and even out. I blow it up, and when I release the pressure, it evens back out. The same thing happens with heat transfer. It's always trying, if you had something that was 80 degrees and something next to it that was 70 degrees, the two would always try and even each other out, but it would always flow from the warmer, the 80 degree substance, to the cooler 70 degree substance. All right, that's just the way that heat transfer flows. And they kind of, I thought that was interesting, use that U-tube manometer analogy in Doolin's, but that's just what I'm showing you right there for a unit of pressure. So this one here is going to measure PSI, all right? And I want to talk to you a little bit about the gauges, because the next thing you're going to be working on are these refrigeration trainers, and you're going to have to follow the steps in this service valve manual. Now, this manual was written by the military back in 1956 or something like that. They used to have an air conditioning and training, air conditioning and refrigeration training facility over here at Fort Belvoir for the military. And then that teacher, after he was trained by the military, came here and taught for like 20 years, right? Before, this is like when the school first opened here in the 60s. So he still has some of these around. This procedure hasn't changed in 60 years. It's the exact same step. There's a few variations to it now because they don't use these older pieces of equipment anymore that had service valves both on the high and the low side. They're using more of the hermetic units now, but they don't put a service valve on the high and the low side. They just put one over here on the low side. So you're gonna also need to be learning about this semester, this next 4 weeks, we're talking about all the different components of the refrigeration cycle. That was kind of the intro for this chapter a little bit, and it was a lot of information, okay? I kind of went over it with the other class, the first like 6 pages yesterday, all right? And that helped a little bit with them, I think. I might come back to that and go over it with you after we talk about what I have to talk about today. So did everybody get the piece off? You see the board on too? Let's go ahead and do that. Get the piece off, grab a screwdriver, take the piece off, and I want you to see behind it. Take a look at it. Take a minute to get that apart. And don't lose anything. Pick up any pieces that drop so that we can put them back together when we're done. And then we're gonna put them back up here. Yes.
I got the old one.
That's a calibration screw. I'll talk about that in a minute. After you get it apart, the one behind it. Those two screws on the back here. Now these ones here have Allen star torques, I think.
Take off the back ones.
Yep, take off the two back ones. You might need a flathead or a Phillips, depending on what type of screw you have. Careful with the screwdriver. If it's too hard to remove because it's kind of stuck and it's a flat blade, let me switch it up and give you another one that's not a flat blade, okay? And then if you don't, I got one or two that didn't put screws back in, so that's kind of easier to handle. Take them all the way out, and then this cover should fall by the wayside here. And then you can kind of see up inside of it.
On both?
Just one. You don't need both. They both look exactly the same on the back side behind the cover. So pretty much all you need to do with the blue one is take the cap off. Do the blue one, because the screws are already out. So just take the cap off, and it'll fall back, and then you can see it.
What if we have screws inside?
Yeah, you gotta take those out too. Yeah. Careful with the glass. Yep. Careful with the glass. You can also. Here's one that's already out, so we can move on. Everybody got it? See the part? I see you got it. Take it apart. Look in the back. Straighten out the board on tube. When you do, look at what happens in the front if you have a needle. Pull on it. Right? Now, if you take a look on the low side gauge, some of you are, when the low side is blue, okay? They color code that blue so that we know it goes on the low pressure side of the system, because that's usually colder than the high pressure side of the system, which we color code that red for the red gauge. So we got two different sides of the unit that we're gonna talk about. But for right now, on the blue gauge, if you take a look, it only accurately will read up to 120 PSI. Beyond that, it does this thing called retard all the way up to 350 PSI. Retard means to impair the gauge. It's going to impair it beyond repair, okay? It's going to damage it, which usually when it goes to retard and it slams the needle, it straightens out the Bourdon tube so much that it can't come back and curl back normally the way it was to zero out. So sometimes you can correct it. Freddie, you asked me what that screw on the front was. You probably won't be able to get a regular flathead in there, but they can make a smaller control screwdriver that if you put that in there, you can adjust the needle where the zero is by turning that calibration screw. So when I turn it clockwise, it moves it down. When I turn it counterclockwise, it moves the needle up. So I can reset the needle at zero, which if you went to different altitudes Let's say you're working in some place that has mountains and valleys, like out in Roanoke, Virginia. You're gonna have a different pressure reading on the gauge when you go up higher in the mountains than you will down here at sea level. Why is that? What's special about Mile High Stadium in Denver?
The air quality.
The air, yeah, not necessarily the quality, but you're right on the money with the air. There's a different amount of air at higher elevations, right, than lower. We're gonna get into that later too, because that deals with something when I set up all this chemistry stuff with boiling points and pressure. But yeah, that could be something as simple, or you could damage the gauge hooking it up to the wrong unit, and then it gets into retard, pegs the needle. Really, it can handle up to 350 without damaging the gauge. It just possibly could damage the gauge, but if it ever pegs over to where that stop is for the needle, it probably, you're gonna have to change out your gauge, which is not a big deal. They screw onto a manifold. Let me talk to you about these parts here real quick. Hey, can you hit escape on that for me? Thank you. So, if you take a look here, why do we have these service valves? What's the point? Why do we need these service valves? Because now, before we can hook up the gauge, I gotta introduce this thing to you. Right here, this is a service valve. And the reason we need it is because it's gonna give us our opening into the air conditioning and refrigeration equipment. We can't tell what's going on with the unit completely. We don't know the whole story until we hook up the gauges, and the only place to hook up a set of gauges is on one of these valves that has a little gauge port right there on it. And this valve, look, here's a valve that you're probably more familiar with. It's called a gate valve. Because look at that water, you've all probably turned one of these for a faucet somewhere, and look, if you turn it clockwise, there's a gate inside that drops down to block the flow. There's an in, there's an out, that's it. There's nothing to it. And that's open and closed. When there's only an in and an out, it's open and closed. We know if it's open because I can see that the gate opens up. Where this is a ball valve up here, same thing though, except it's got a ball inside, and you saw me turn that like 6-7 times to open it and close it. This is how you open and close a ball valve. It's a 90 degree turn. And if you ever see one of these valves, and this valve is perpendicular to the way the line goes, that's off. When it's in line with the line, that's on. Okay? I'm gonna pass these around. Take a look inside. Woo. Yeah, well.
Oh, this is like use it for bathrooms or stuff?
Use it for a lot for water. Yeah, we can also use them. We use our gas cocks that are ball valves now for the natural gas lines, a lot of them. We really, the gate valve's kind of old school. And this is a different, this is a plunger. This went on, and instead of it being a gate, this one adjusted with a plunger. It plunged to stop an opening inside the body of the valve. So that's a little different variation on the gate, but it's the same type of principle. But when we get to the service valves here, you're gonna see that there's really no open and closed, because I don't just have an in and an out. This is my line. This is where it comes in and goes to the compressor right here. So I got my in and my out, but look, I also got a little gauge port up here. Well, that's another in and out right there. And I have another one on the bottom. This one has two gauge ports, one near the line, one back near the stem. Let me talk to you about this service valve real quick. Take a look at the next page, because this is where you're gonna use the colored pencils. First, use black. We're gonna look at the body, all right? So this is the body. You like my body? Huh? Oh, you all look. All right, look, if I was to take this service valve and cut it directly in half with a hacksaw, this is what you would see. So I want you to put some side cuts to show you that this is a cutout view of this. And all this right here that I'm putting, all this in, this is the body, okay? The valve body, all this on the outside. Now most of them, when you come up to them, are gonna have a cap. So here's what I got here like that, except for this one has two gauge ports. Forget about that. So that's pretty much what you're looking at. But look, there's a cap, number six. That's a cap. We got to pull the cap off. When you turn this, you're not opening or closing anything. You're just exposing the cap, taking the cap off to expose the stem. All right? So the stem, take a green marker. There's a stem. All valves have them. Whether it's a water valve for your faucet or service valves for our air conditioning equipment, you got this bar that extends down into the body of the valve. That all right here, that is our stem, and the stem has a face, all right? The stem has a face up here. Color that face in. Now take a look. I'm going to go back to the bar gauge manifold set. If I take this manifold out, right, I unscrew this, there is a little piece that goes between the two parts here that blocks the flow. Now I'm not going to come out because that was level two. I'm not going to be able to get it out, I don't think. It's stuck in there. Somebody didn't clip it in before they put it back in. That's funny.
Kids, gotta love them.
All right, I can't pull it out, pull out this valve seat, but we can show you another way. All right, so look, there's a thing called a packing gland in between where the stem goes into the body. I'm gonna color that red. So that's this piece in here. That's the piece I was trying to take out of the gauge to show you. I'll have to take it further apart in a minute to see if you can do it. But this right here, every washer has one. That's how they keep the pressure from the water coming out here, the stem of the valve. It's a little rubber grommet on some of them. Some are metal, some are hard plastic. But that packing gland in here, right here, there's a nut that goes over it right here. That holds back the water, or in our case, the refrigerant pressure, from coming out and shooting out when we remove or backseat or frontseat the stem. I can see that one here. That one's got a little, that's my packing nut right here. So if I take a wrench and loosen it up, I can take this whole piece out, and now I can, if I had a pair of pliers, a different pair, I could pull this. It takes a little bit of pressure, it's a little bit of work, because this thing's packed down in there. But I pull the nut out, there's a washer, and this little seat can come out. And that's what holds back the pressure. So I'm going to go ahead and put that back in. And that's pretty much it. Now, right now, with this valve, this is called the backseated position. This is backseated. You are seated in a seat. Can you get anything between your butt and the seat? Try it. Let me see. Sit down on the seat and try and get your hand to the other side. Can you do it? Try it. Don't lift up. No, you lift it up. You got to be seated. It means to be seated. Joe, I don't see you playing my game. Can you get the hand through when you're seated? How is it? No? Can't do it. Can't do it. That's what it means to be seated. It's closed off. Look, right here, this face of the stem is blocking right here on the body. So this is my seat right here. I'm going to color that blue actually right here. So this is my seat. So what this is doing, it's blocking the flow of refrigerant. So if refrigerant's coming from the compressor and it's getting pumped out to the line, it can't go around here and get up to my gauge. It can only come from the compressor out to the line, or from the line back to the compressor. It can only go this way, or it can only go this way, back and forth. I can't go up and show up anything on the gauge port. So this is how the valve should be when I come to hook up my gauge right on it. It should be backseated all the way, backseated. That means to turn it counterclockwise. What you want you to do this here, put a little square down here, because that would be like if you're looking at the stem and you go counterclockwise, that's back in time, counterclockwise, CCW, that is backseating. Careful, don't break the tools. All right, so turning counterclockwise is backseating. You want to make sure this thing is backseated before you pull off this cap, because if this thing isn't backseated, I go up to this unit right here, and before I know if the position of the valve's open or closed, backseated, frontseated, and I start taking off this cap, and it's open, and this thing's fully charged to refrigerant, what's going to happen when I pull off the cap to a certain point?
Shoot up.
Yeah, everything's going to shoot out. It's going to be a bad news thing. So for safety consideration, we got to remove the cap first. You'll see that in the steps. Remove the stem cap and make sure the valve is all the way backseated, which means you're going to need one of these. Remember this from the tool list? Showed you one of these. This is the refrigeration service valve wrench. This reversible. So I'm going to take it, there's a different size stem, this is a quarter inch, and I'm going to back it out all the way before I pull this cap out. So you see that it ratchets, all right, and I'm going, if I'm looking at the stem, back in time, backwards, counterclockwise. All the way back. Now it's seated, just like you. So now I can safely remove the gauge port and start to hook up my gauges. That's one position, back seated. Now, the next position, turn the page to the next one. Now, I'm gonna take it, and we were all the way in the back position first. I'm gonna pass this around too so you can play around with it. So if I'm all the way in the back position, and then I turn it a quarter turn forward, that's defined as cracking. That's what we call cracking the valve. And if I was all the way in the back seat, and I take it and I turn a quarter turn this way, half turn, I'm cracking it off the back seat. So now what I've done is I've taken this seat, by turning this stem a quarter turn, half turn, it's moving forward a little bit. And now check it out. The refrigerant can go from the compressor out to the line, and it can go, it's three dimensional, around the stem and out the gauge port. Or I can add refrigerant into the unit or into the line. So now the line port's open, it goes to the other parts. The gauge port's open. It's gonna hook to this manifold here. And my compressor port is open. Let's go back to the other one real quick. Write all those down. Which ones were open here? What we say? The line port, yep, open. What else was open? The compressor port was open. And the gauge port? That's closed. Now, I'm gonna take this valve and I'm gonna go all the way forward. So we took it, we cracked it. Now I can get all the ports. If I take this service valve and I continue turning clockwise, right? I continue turning clockwise. I'm gonna push this seat, this valve stem and face all the way forward, and this is gonna be my seat now. So when I push it all the way forward, eventually it's gonna block one of the other ports. The line port. So now refrigerant can't escape and go through the system, right? Because one side's sucking, the other side's blowing out, discharging. If I had the suction one front seated all the way, that means no refrigerant can come down. It's blocked right here. If I had this one blocked and the compressor's running, the pressure's building up. And that could be dangerous for you. Because if there's a lot of refrigerant in here, and you front seat the discharge service valve, the one that's supposed to be letting the gas come out and go into the rest of the unit. If you front seat this and run this compressor, what's gonna happen to the pressure? Yeah, it's gonna build up. And one of these little gaskets, which is a spongy material between two pieces of metal, or something else internal in the compressor, is gonna be damaged. If the gasket blows out, you could have refrigerant and oil come out and get on you, okay? In which case, we could just change the gasket. You're probably gonna have to change your clothes because it's messy. It blows out and it gets a little nasty. Or if those gaskets don't blow out, it could blow up if you build up enough pressure. All right, it could blow something else out, which is dangerous. So when we have this valve front seated, you do not run the unit. It's just for you guys right now. There'll be some other things that we do where you can, but for right now, level one, do not run the unit. Put a star next to that. All right, with the valve front seated, all the way forward. So remember, looking at the stem, back seating was turning counterclockwise. Front seating is turning clockwise. All right, and you can see that. I'm gonna pass that around here for you. I'm also gonna try and get this manifold gauge piece out so I can show you that as well. But take the valve, take the service valve wrench, front seat it, back seat it. All right, take a look in the center when you do it. Now, let's take a look at the ports. Which ones are open now?
Gauge,
yep, gauge is open.
And compressor's
open. And the line port now is closed. So hey, real quick question, which one was open the whole time? One of them was open, which is why we don't say open or closed, because the valves are always have one port open. The compressor port. It's always open to this port right here because there isn't a valve for it to shut it off. I can shut off the line, I can shut off the gauges, but yeah, no matter which way I put that valve, forward or back, the compressor port was always open. Now the service valves on the air conditioning equipment, those of you, I know your parents or somebody works in HVAC, all right? You might have come up and you might see a valve like this on the, this is refrigeration valves here. Because the refrigeration work is a little more critical than the HVAC work as far as when we open up a unit and stuff, the things we have to do are more frequent. So we use a lot of flared connections, a lot of valves that we can take off and put back on. Whereas the air conditioning unit, once it's installed, aside from checking the pressures every now and then on the unit for maintenance, we really don't need to mess with the valves there. We don't need to do anything to them, but they still have valves. The valve for this one's on the liquid and the suction line, and theirs look a little different. Their cap, you pull it off, it uses, instead of the service valve wrench, you can get an adapter for the valve wrench that goes inside, but this is really a 3/16 Allen key. So I get the 3/16 Allen key, and I gotta put it in this one to be able to turn the valve, okay? And it's still front seating, back seating. I still have an in, an out, only this one's not a compressor port. I got a liquid line in, liquid line out, gauge port. Or I could have a suction line in, suction line out, suction port. But same thing, turn it, now it's front seated all the way. Now it's back seated all the way. All right, but it's a different type of service valve, but it is a service valve. Again, talking about the valves, I got a check valve here. Think about a valve, a check valve, only being like one way. It's got an arrow on it. When I blow through the check valve this way, it blows. When I blow through it the opposite way against the arrow, I can't get it, it won't blow back. It's only a one-way valve, all right? And these are mostly used on water lines. Because remember when we were doing the PVC project, I had you hook up to the water line? Well, what if you had some nasty stuff in that PVC, and when you took it off, it went back into the water system? So that when somebody goes down here and drinks a water fountain, they're actually drinking whatever was in your plastic project. Some of the glue, some of the cleaner, whatever. Can't have that. This is a one-way valve that connects to all the outlets so that, especially the garden hoses, so they can't let the water get back into your home system. All right, it's a one-way check valve. We also use them in a couple different things in HVAC. So, but valves, think about valves being open and closed, but then you need to think beyond open and closed to backseated, frontseated, and cracked. The last thing I wanna show you is this page here, the bar gauge manifold set. Aha. All right, I want you to take the blue and the red markers. We usually color code the gauges. Let me just view that thing full screen. All right, I want you to color code on yours. Compound gauge, which we'll get into what those numbers mean later, is blue. And the pressure gauge is red. So that knows that we connect the red up to the hot part of the system or the high side of the system. There's a direct relationship between temperature and pressure. If the temperature's high, the pressure's probably gonna be high. If the temperature's low, the pressure's probably gonna be low. And so they think about temperature low, cold, temperature high, red, just stuff that you already dealt with all your life. But it didn't have to be that way. They could color code them really anything they want. Also, take a look. This is a half cutaway view of this bar gauge manifold set. All right, and normally it comes with a set of hoses. Let me show you some of the hoses. Remember you had to pay special attention to the hoses when you were hooking up the nitrogen tank to the regulator. Because remember, what did one set side of hose have that the other one didn't? The little thing in the center, right? What'd that thing in the center do? Pushes the Schrader valve out. Yep, remember the Schrader valve? I thought I had one up in here in one of these, but that's all right. Yeah, the Schrader valve, yep, and this one doesn't have that depend. So look, when you're hooking up the hoses for the first time, there's a set of ports right underneath the gauges. Try and set up, look, there's a straight end, the 45 has that Schrader valve core depressor. The straight end goes right underneath the gauge of the color it represents. So a blue hose will go underneath the blood, and it stays straight. The ones on the back are plugs. They're dead ends, caps like the filter dryer project. Only reason we have those is so when you pull these things out of the truck, you're not dragging them in the dirt. And they don't get dirty and stuff inside when they're sitting idle. So when we don't use the other end of the hose, we just hook it up to the back of the dead end plug. That's all we do with it. Also, the gauges do not need to be open. I don't need to turn the valve to read pressure. The way that gauge, the Bourdon tube works, is that the pressure comes in from the high side here, it goes around this needle and comes up and straightens out the Bourdon tube. So this valve on the side, these have got to be closed, all right? You got to make sure the valves to the gauges are closed when you're hooking them up at all times. And they might not be closed. Somebody else might have had them open for something else when they were working on them. So you need to physically come up and make sure that they are righty tight. And it shows you on the side, closed with the arrow. Take a look at it the first few times because it's opposite. When you're closing this one this way, this one goes the opposite way. And you need to make sure they're closed before you hook them up, because if you open up the pressure here and this gauge was open, it will come from the unit, here's the red one again, and come out through this hose here. And if this hose isn't on tight on the back, you're gonna get liquid and oil and maybe vapor refrigerant on you, okay? So you gotta make sure that both the valves are closed when you're hooking up the gauges, and they do not need to be open to read pressure for the bar gauge manifold set. So what we're gonna do now is I'm gonna give you some hoses. We're gonna go back in the tool room. I'm gonna give you actually a whole set of gauges. You're gonna take the hoses off, because you see how they're put on, and then you're gonna put the hoses back on. That's gonna be the task for the next minute or so. Also, I'd like you to put back together the practice ones I gave you. All right, put all the screws back in, caps back on, and put them up here, and then come on over to the tool room, and I'll give you a set of gauges. And we're just gonna take the hoses off. Now careful, the hoses might have some oil or other liquids inside them. So just be careful when you're taking the gauges off with the hoses and everything.